Thank you for joining us today for what I think will be a very interesting session. Gear up to manage your assets. My name is Bob Hawkins. I'm a city councillor in Regina and a director of SUMA. My job this afternoon is the easy job. I have to give a few logistical instructions and then turn it over to the folks that really know what they're doing. First of all, I want you to note that the fire exits, the evacuation plan, and the AED location are all marked on pages 26 to 29 of your Convention 2017 handbook. I very much hope that we don't have to use any of those things, but it's comforting to know that they're there. And if you have a moment, it'd be great if you took a look at it so that we're all safe. I'd ask you to note that this session is being audio recorded. That means when it comes time for questions and you step up to the mic, I'd ask you to identify yourself, Bob Hawkins, indicate the municipality if you're from, City of Regina, and I'm asking you to do that because on the audio recording, those recordings will be posted on the SUMA YouTube channel, and it makes recording more understandable if we can hear clearly the question and then clearly the answer. I'm not going to read the biographies of our panelists, not because they're not very distinguished, they are, but what we've done is we've put those on the free app for SUMA, the event-based free app. Though bios are there and you can download the apps for free. I don't want to take time from what they have to say to go through biographies. It's now my pleasure to introduce the panel. Shelley Funk behind me is the business manager for NAMS Canada Inc. That's National Asset Management Strategy Canada Inc. She'll be refereeing the panel and keeping everybody on time and in the right order. Darian Brown, ATANA Management, and George Tomporowski, the mayor of Shellbrook, will be making a presentation jointly together. To their right, Celine Favreau, Director of Operations and Planning with MidSask Municipal Alliance, and finally Joanne Lois to her right, the administrator for the village of Marsden. We're very grateful to them that they come today, give of their time and share their knowledge with us. I'd ask you to give them a warm welcome and welcome to yourselves.
Good afternoon, everyone. As Bob said, my name is Shelley Funk, and I am a retired administrator. I've been retired for 2 years, and I was asked to get involved with NAMS Canada, and because of my work while I was an administrator, I basically said, sure, part-time job, not a problem. Well, it's a challenging position to be in, because we're in challenging times. Anyway, I'd like to start by introducing our panel in a little more detail. And first, myself, I was administrator for the town of Dalmany for 20 years, and prior to that, administrator for the town of Aberdeen. And in 2011, I became aware of the NAMS program of asset management, and it was a follow-up to the public sector accounting exercise that had been mandated to municipalities starting in by the end of 2009. So it seemed like a logical step to move into that that avenue, but little did I know how interesting it would be, and it would capture my attention. So from 2011 to 2015, I assisted in developing the asset plan for the town of Dalmany. And then in 2015, when I retired, I was asked to be the business manager for NAMS Canada Inc., and that's my position as of today. The other presenters, there is actually one more bio that's on the that you will find on that list, and it's Nicole Allen. You will see a video. She's not here in person today, but she has prepared a video on asset management. So, and Nicole Allen is the Director of Asset Management for ATANA Management Incorporated. She's a co-trainer, and she was one of the trainers when I took the NAMS program, and I can see a few faces in the audience that have actually taken the training as well. She has led asset management development for 24 municipalities, including 18 communities in larger cities in Alberta and BC. George Tomporowski is the mayor of Shellbrook, as you heard. He was 35 years with Sask Highways, and he was the area manager, and he was introduced to asset management at that time. So before he got involved as a mayor, he already knew all about asset management, right, George? In Shellbrook, this was the first small urban municipality in Saskatchewan to have asset management plans completed for water, sanitary sewer, roads, storm sewer, curb, and gutters. And George is currently working with Darian Brown on the asset management plan for buildings. He is also the chair of the NAMS user group of Saskatchewan, and that is a group of about, I'm thinking about 55 communities who have taken the NAMS training and who have worked in some capacity on their asset plans. Darian Brown, to my right, is Director of Technical Services for ATANA Management Incorporated. He has experience with a number of asset management projects for urban and rural communities, and I think he's worked on a number of plans with various people in the audience as well. Celine Favreau is the Director of Operations and Planning for MidSask Municipal Alliance, called MSMA. So I'll call it MSA from now on, MSMA. She was 25 years with Community and Economic Development, Business Development, and Regional Development. She's Professional Community and Economic Development of Saskatchewan designation. And she managed a project that involved the development of asset management plans for each of the 12 MSMA member municipalities. And Celine will provide an overview of that project. And finally, Joanne Loy. Joanne is CAO of the RM of Manitou Lake and the Village of Marsden, and has been in that position for 13 years. She has a business administration diploma from NAIT. She has a local government administration certificate from U of R. And she has a National Advanced Certificate of Local Authority Administration from the University of Alberta. She took the 3-day training in 2012 and 13, the face-to-face training, as we call it now. She has an IPWEA Professional Certificate in Asset Management Planning certificate, and she took it in 2016 as an online course. And this course is a new course. It's just been started up, so it's something that Joanne will provide more information on with her presentation. And she, as a result of that, she managed a project that involved the development of the asset management plan for the RM of Manitou Lake in 2016. So, before we get into the information, what I would like to do is just give you a few pieces of information on that we have available. We have a handout, and all of the links, the online links to the presentation is on that handout. So you don't have to write anything down. You don't have to worry about taking notes. The session is recorded as well, so you'll be able to go back and study, and you can listen attentively instead. So we've got the handout, and it's got multiple links to various programs. It's up at the front. At the end of the session, please take one. We've got 50 copies right now, so I'm thinking that if it's possible for you to take one per municipality, that would be appreciated. We also have a little box sitting at the front for you to drop your business card or your name and your email address or your phone number in. We have a raffle that we're offering, providing, and it's a $100 gift certificate to Staples. We thought that that might be appropriate for your municipality. So, and we'd love to get your business cards and your contact information. So please feel free to use the raffle. We also have a sign-up sheet, and we'd appreciate if you would sign that. And again, one per municipality would be fine. So a lot of this information that we're providing is already available on the SUMA Getting Started piece that's on the SUMA website. This was created in 2011, and it's still very relevant to what today's activities are all about. It was created with the cooperation of SARM, SUMA, RMA, the Rural Municipal Administrators, and UMIS, the Urban Municipal Administrators, Government Relations, and the New North. And there was funding by the Government of Canada and the Government of Saskatchewan through the Rural Municipal Infrastructure Fund. So it was it's a very comprehensive guide to getting started for anyone who is new to asset management, and a good review for those of us who haven't looked at it for a while. I even learned a few things. One other thing I just ask, I know Bob said that the microphones are available. They're all live, with the exception of the front three. So we'd ask, when at the end there will be an opportunity for questions, and we'd ask that you go to the microphone, and whoever goes there first, please turn it on, or just check to make sure it's on, and then please state your name and where you're from. And we'd really appreciate that. And one more thing, if you have a cell phone, could you put it to silent, please? I know I almost forgot mine. So, yeah, the agenda. Okay, so this is the agenda that we've got in front of us. I'm going to give a review of the Canadian Municipal Infrastructure Report Card, the FCM Asset Management Fund. We're going to have a video from FCM, and then there'll be an overview. I'm going to provide an overview of the recent gas tax agreements. We will have a video from Nicole Allen on getting started in asset management. And finally, our panel will provide their experiences from their point of view. And I'm hoping to get everybody out of here by 2:30. And there'll be about 20 minutes for questions and answers. So let's get started. So the Canadian Infrastructure Report Card, it was put together in 2016 at the federal level. And what it was is it was an objective assessment of the state of infrastructure and infrastructure management. 120 communities were identified. Municipalities own the core infrastructure assets that are critical to the quality of life of Canadians and the competitiveness of our country. What the report card found was that one-third of our municipal infrastructure is in fair, poor, or very poor condition, increasing the risk of service disruption. Building for today's communities and tomorrow's Canada requires long-term planning. And in other words, a penny now or a dollar later. The report card emphasizes the importance of having an asset management process in place. Having credible asset management plans and practices will increase the longevity of the assets, optimize investments in maintenance and rehabilitation, and inform the public, decision makers, and other stakeholders. And for me, the third one is a very important one for municipalities, because communities they know that they need things to be done, but where's the money going to come from? And having a buy-in from the taxpayer is really important to be able to do the work. I added this slide because it was part of the infrastructure report card report, and it says a lot to me And what it does is it shows basically how having an asset in the first three quarters of the asset's life, it is relatively, it has relatively little deterioration. The last quarter of the life is when the deterioration is most predominant. So if that asset can be rehabilitated before it gets to 75% of its useful value, of its life cycle, that's when you get the best bang for the buck, hence the penny, a penny now, a dollar later concept. And for me, this slide was the slide I remembered the most from the training that I took for asset management. So I just wanted to put that in there. Okay. So the Federation of Canadian Municipalities has put together, they've received funds from the federal government, and the highlights of that fund is they've developed in partnership with Infrastructure Canada and delivered through collaboration with the provincial and territorial municipal associations, and they're calling them the PTAs. That's one of the many acronyms in new acronyms that are being used. It's a five-year, $50 million fund to help Canadian communities establish and enhance asset management practices. So there's three components to the fund. It generates awareness of the benefits of asset management. It is providing direct application-based funding to municipalities to develop and implement their own asset management practices. And it's also creating a nationwide resource to build and transfer knowledge and expertise and share best practices. So that online information is going to be available. It's just ramping up right now, and FCM has been consulting with community associations and such as SUMA and SARM and user groups across the country, and they're just putting the final touches together. So okay, so FCM has created a video, and it's available on their website, but we thought it's only about 4 minutes long, so we thought that it would be useful for you to see that, their words rather than mine.
Hi, I'm Lisa, the mayor of my town. The role of my council is to ensure that residents are provided with services that are essential to our quality of life, like clean drinking water and sanitation, transportation, parks and recreation services. Our community's infrastructure assets are critical to deliver these services. Today, like in many Canadian communities, one-third of my town's assets are in poor condition, in part because most of our assets were built in the 50s and 60s and are reaching the end of their useful life. At the same time, our community has grown, and so has the demand for new and improved services. We've also had to spend money to upgrade our assets to comply with new environmental and safety standards. We made investment decisions based on our ability to finance the upfront development costs. However, the bigger ongoing costs to operate, maintain, and eventually replace these assets were not fully built into the analysis. Plus, our assets are vulnerable. Climate change has resulted in impacts from more severe storms, flooding, and other unexpected events. Our assets were not designed with these impacts in mind. For example, one of our roads was washed out during last spring's flood, and we had to reprioritize and redirect money in response. Now we're caught in a cycle where new infrastructure is needed to service growth that has been sprawling beyond the core. Residents count on us to deliver exceptional services. We need to catch up on overdue maintenance of existing assets and to finance the replacements of our old ones. We strive to keep taxes and fees low. However, the revenue we collect to manage all this isn't keeping pace with it all. So my council has been faced with some tough decisions. Do we adjust tax rates? Do we delay maintenance and repairs even longer and risk the consequences? how much should we place annually in a reserve fund? Do we reduce the level of services? Do we delay new projects? So what are we doing? We're engaging in asset management planning to be more strategic about how we manage our assets and spending. We're reviewing our assets across all departments in a holistic and integrated way. We're evaluating the full life cycle costs of different capital assets and land use decisions to ensure we're choosing the best long-term option for the community. To become more resilient to a changing climate, we're developing a climate adaptation plan and starting to identify how we can become less dependent on fossil fuels. We now recognize the value of the services our natural assets provide, like managing stormwater and improving water quality. We're also speaking to residents about the cost of service delivery and their needs and priorities. All this work is helping us to coordinate our infrastructure work and set priorities. Now we have an ongoing process in place that is proactive and allows us now to make better informed and strategic decisions. We're now much better placed to support my town's economy and our residents' quality of life sustainably. The health of our assets is central to achieving these goals. Do some of my town's challenges seem familiar to you?
Okay, so how do we do this? One of the tools that has been given to communities in the last number of years is the gas tax funding. And it can't provide everything, but it is a very, it's a long-term fund that is predictable, and it is $613 million over 10 years. I know that some of your communities have already accessed it. When I was still working, I was involved in a couple of years of accessing for the core assets, which for my community, it was sewer, a lot of sewer issues. And it allowed our community to be able to rehabilitate and upgrade the existing infrastructure. The gas tax agreement requires that municipalities make progress towards developing and implementing an asset management plan prior to March 31st, 2018. So you don't have to have a full-fledged plan, but having a plan to that can be seen to be a credible plan is very important for success. The schedule in the gas tax agreement, it's Schedule F in the agreement, and many of you will have seen this this schedule. Some won't, but ask your administrator; they'll be able to help you find it. The schedule indicates that Saskatchewan acknowledges best practices and prudent infrastructure management can strengthen both the provinces and the municipalities. What they have decided, what's in the schedule, indicates that a tiered approach to set goals appropriate for the current state of asset management in individual municipalities is the best way to handle it. So, the smaller communities that that don't have a lot of infrastructure, a simple asset plan is satisfactory. As the community gets larger and the infrastructure levels get higher, the values get higher. The type of asset plan required is of a higher level. The goals are to be developed in collaboration with an oversight committee, and this is something that has been established in the last couple, just in the last year, I believe, an oversight committee that will be determining the goals that are appropriate for the various levels of the municipalities, and more advanced goals being set for larger communities. So the summary of this, and originally this, this presentation on gas tax was to be provided by one of the government relations staff, but because of the by-election that was called on Friday, she is not able to be here. So I'm just providing the bare bones. She would have had a more in-depth presentation. But all of this information, again, is available online. The take-home summary of this is to successfully access gas tax funding, each municipality should have a credible asset management plan in place for all core infrastructure by March 31st, 2018. Now that again depends on the level of the community. So the best thing is to work with the government staff to determine what that level would involve. There are now international guidelines across the world. These are worldwide guidelines for asset management for credible asset management plans. And they take into account a large variety of factors, including risk management and level of service and a whole bunch of things that you'll be learning more about shortly. And they're called the ISO 55000. So if you see that term, you know that it's a credible asset management plan. So now we have another video that is prepared by Nicole Allen from ATANA Management, and we will watch that now.
Hi, and welcome to a quick overview about how you can get started with asset management for your organization. Many of you know me, but for those who don't, my name is Nicole Allen, and I am a professional engineer who focuses on providing asset management support and training. I work with a small company called ATANA Management. At ATANA Management, our specialty is helping you make good decisions. We provide decision support and specifically focus on infrastructure. We provide training and support for all aspects of asset management. We work locally, nationally, and internationally. If you ever have questions regarding moving forward with asset management, please don't hesitate to contact us. A few years ago, ATANA worked closely with SUMA by providing technical expertise and helping them develop their Asset Management Getting Started Guide. The purpose of the guide was to help communities like yours better understand what asset management is and how to get started down this path. And that's what I'm going to talk about today. Anytime we talk about asset management, we need to do so within the context of existing standards and frameworks. Internationally, this includes the International Standard for Asset Management, ISO 55000, and also the International Infrastructure Management Manual, the IIMM. Nationally and locally, we need to be aware of how asset management relates to gas tax funding and other grant requirements. We've seen in other provinces, such as BC and Ontario, other grants being based on asset management progress. So why is asset management important? Well, there are numerous reasons, but to start with just a few, we are moving from a period of significant building to a period of renewal and managing infrastructure that we already have. This is also known as aging infrastructure. Also, we're seeing changes to the available funding for infrastructure and the requirements to actually access that funding in terms of things like gas tax funding and other provincial grants. And finally, we're seeing more of an expectation and a demand for informed decision making and governance. So, understanding that we need this sort of information to make good decisions and to be able to communicate our decisions to other stakeholders. Today we'll look at three different topics: getting familiar with asset management, getting started with asset management, and finally, next steps. So what exactly is asset management? Well, asset management is really about how we manage our infrastructure assets to provide services to our users and stakeholders in a way that meets their expectations and is sustainable into the future. And what is infrastructure? Well, infrastructure includes physical assets that support our standard of living, safety, well-being, and economic prosperity. It's things like water, sanitary, storm sewer, road networks, our facilities, all these sorts of things that we use to provide services. Okay, let's assume we all agree an asset management plan is a good idea. What do we need to include as part of the discussion? Well, first we need to consider a life cycle approach for our infrastructure. That means including all the costs we'll experience over the life of the asset. Planning, operations, maintenance, renewal, and so on. We also need to consider if we have the most cost-effective management strategies in place. Are there things that we could do to actually reduce the cost of providing these services? Next, we need to talk and define the level of service or the quality of service that we will provide. We need to consider how the demands for these services are going to change in the future. We also need to consider the risks associated with providing these services and how we manage these. Finally, we need to look at what we need to do better going forward to make sure we can make the best decisions. So how do we improve this the next time? So back to that key question about why asset management is so important. Well, we need the information from an asset management plan to make informed decisions, to plan for the future by knowing upcoming costs and expenditures and budgets, by understanding risk and understanding where we are and where we're not meeting service expectations. You might be thinking, but we already do lots of different planning. Do we need an asset management plan as well? The answer is yes. We don't actually do this sort of infrastructure planning anywhere else, and there's significant costs and implications associated with it. Think of asset management as part of the bigger planning picture. We'll refer to this entire planning process as integrated planning. Integrated planning includes all the planning that we do at the organizational level. It's high-level strategic plans, like master plans, like official community plans, the more focused asset management plans, long-term financial plans, risk plans, and things like annual work plans and budgets as well, just to name a few. These plans all work together to provide guidance and direction for our organizations moving forward, and asset management plans become just one key part of that. So why should you care about asset management? Well, asset management is important for municipal staff because it supports better management of infrastructure and ensures long-term sustainable provision of services. It's also important for elected officials as it supports better governance and more informed decision-making. Asset management is also how we can communicate future infrastructure needs to other levels of government and to the users and stakeholders of those services. And finally, it is the new expectation internationally. It's not going away. Asset management is seen as good practice around the world. So how can you get started with asset management? Well, the first thing is you need to define what the end goal is. What are you trying to achieve? How will you use this information? Next, consider the information that you already have available to use. And finally, think about the information that you really need but don't have. We always want to base our first asset management plans off of existing information without committing our organizations to getting a bunch of new data. We can develop appropriate asset registers based on whatever exists. We can consider current infrastructure budgets, project upcoming work, and get training and support to further educate ourselves. So how do we develop an asset register for asset management purposes? Well, we start with the best register we have available. We make sure it's up to date, so all of our new infrastructure has been added and older infrastructure that's been disposed of has been removed. We also want to make sure that we have appropriate useful lives assigned to each asset. So not based on a policy, but based on how long we actually think it will last. And finally, we need to also include current replacement costs. So instead of having a historic value, what would it cost to replace that asset today? Next, we might consider future planned work and available funding. So first off, what work is planned for the future for your assets in terms of renewals and upgraded new infrastructure? How much do you plan to spend on it in terms of operations, maintenance, renewal, upgrade, and new work? levels of service is also seen as one of the key components of an asset management plan. So a bit more on what that is. While levels of service are about matching the quality of the service that you provide with the expectations and affordability of the community, we must be able to define the level of service we currently provide, as well as how changes in our current level of service would impact long-term costs. Now, level of service discussions can get quite complicated, but at a simple level, it's about what you provide, is it getting better, worse, or staying the same, are your customers satisfied, and what are the actual activities that you do to provide that service? Why is risk management so important? Well, what we've really seen in recent years is the idea that the appropriate level for this risk management discussion or the acceptance of risk is at the elected level. It is the responsibility of staff and elected officials to understand and discuss risks associated with service provision. One of the most important things to come out of our initial asset management plans is an understanding of where we do and do not have good information. Continuous improvement is about defining areas where we have low confidence and want to improve going forward. Keep in mind that the appropriate level of asset management maturity is different for every organization. This has been a very high-level overview of the key parts of an asset plan. But if you have an appropriate asset register, you have an idea of upcoming work and the available budget, and you have some discussion on level of service and risk, you're well on your way to getting started with an asset management discussion. So what might next steps look like? We always start with the best information available. We need to understand how we will use asset information within our organization. Next, don't assume that buying software or doing condition assessments is a good place to start. These are very helpful tools, but only once you know what you need. And finally, you might find that the next best step is getting additional training and support. If you're trying to figure out how you will use this information, you might find it helpful to talk to others who are already using this asset management information to support informed decision making. What about additional training and support? What does that look like? There are lots of asset management training options available. While short sessions can be helpful in understanding key principles, it often takes more time to dive into the details of what should be included and how you can actually get and compile this information into a plan. There are options for both online or in-person training sessions. If this is something that you are interested in, one resource that you can look into is namscanada.org. You might also find it helpful to talk to others. This might be other municipalities who are well into their asset management journey, or it could be asset management experts who can provide options for next steps. Asset management will provide you with the information that you need to sustainably provide services into the future for your organization. This will become information that your decision makers rely on in the future. If you have any questions about asset management, there are no shortages of resources. You can contact me at any time. You can look into the SUMA Asset Management Getting Started Guide. You can talk to others who've gone down the path, and you can check out training opportunities at namscanada.org. Thank you for your time, and I look forward to talking with you in the future.
Okay, it's a lot to take in. Our panel have gone through the journey and are still going through the journey, because asset management, as you can now see, is there's no end to it. It's a continuation of best practices in our community. And just when you think that you've found out all there is to know about asset management, you don't. It's an ongoing activity. We have three different groups, four people that are going to present. And I'll turn this over now to George Tomporowski from Shellbrook and Darian Brown to give their take on their journey to date and the lessons that they've learned. Okay.
Thanks, Shelley, and good afternoon, everyone. Just a bit of history. I don't know whether you're familiar with the town of Shellbrook or not, but we're a community of about 1,500 folks. Started our journey in 2012, took some training on an asset management program, and have gone down that path. And I just really like to reinforce what Shelley just said. It's not a one-time effort. It really is about changing your business process. And as we go down the path, we continue to learn more and more things. So with that, we'll get started here. Yeah, I'll let you run that. That'd be perfect. We're good. Talk about sort of what we've done to date, some of the lessons we've learned along the way, and where we hope to go from here, sort of where we've been, where we are, and where we want to go kind of thing. So with that, as of today, we have asset management plans completed on water, wastewater, roads, curb and gutter, curb gutter and storm sewer, I should say, and we are working on the buildings component of it. The plans have gone to council, have been approved, and we've also realized that there needs to be a link between all of your planning. So we have created a strategic plan that, and the strategic plan is actually linked to the asset management plans. In 2017, we want to continue to upgrade, revise our buildings plan. We are working on that, and Darren's going to talk about this, about some of the data that we have and how we might improve that. We're going to start to work on a long-term financial plan, and we hope to formally engage our community, and we want to talk about infrastructure risks with a little more with our council. This next chart is just a snapshot of all of the various plans that we have. The asset management plans themselves are, when you get all the appendices and so on, are probably, I don't know, 100 plus pages. So it's a pretty comprehensive report. And I'll talk about that a little bit more here down in the presentation. What we've learned, sort of moving forward, it became evident very early on in the process. I think we took the training in June of 2012. We're really excited about it. Went back, you know, we're going to get this done. Yeah, we're going to get this done. About October, I asked our administrator, where are we? Well, we haven't quite got around, but, you know, we're going to have a little lull here in November and we'll get started. December comes around. Have we started yet? No, we haven't. And I think at that point, we realized that most offices, especially in small municipalities, are at or over capacity for the amount of people that you have. And if we're going to get anything done, we have to engage some asset management professionals to help us with this. So our choice was ATANA. They have the expertise, they understand how the software works, they have a lot of knowledge that and can do a lot of the background work for you. Ultimately, the decisions lie with staff and ultimately with councils in a lot of the key decision areas. So the other thing that we found, that it is really important that you have a long-term relationship with your professionals, because it is a journey, and it's like we've started 5 years ago, we're still on that journey. One of the other things we found that the financial data that we were gathering and the system we were using was just didn't really fit with our whole asset management approach. So we did change our financial system, and we're in the process of refining and developing more detailed work tracking and costing models. This next slide is just, again, I think Nicole referred to that, but it just shows you how integrated all the planning steps are, and they're not disengaged from one another at all. It's just everything is so integrated, and asset management plans just help you get to where you need to and want to be. In the early stages, one of the key, and I don't think we were unlike a lot of small communities, you really didn't have any written down record. We had an asset register of sorts, but no sort of detailed information on what we had for resources. So one of the early things was mapping of the infrastructure. And the other thing was that we needed to do, we found, was to edit the asset register and put it in such a form that it actually was usable within the context of the asset management plans. And the other one of the other with the first plan that we developed was we could really use this information for projecting upcoming work. The next couple of slides here are just some of the information that's in an asset management plan. The first, I think, is this is a shot of the road structures within our community by surface type. So we have the various surface types, and it just gives you a really quick snapshot of what we have. The next one is of our sanitary system. And this is a summary by year of construction. So real quick snapshot, you can see some stuff is, the kind of orange colored stuff was built in the 60s. So within our community, we have quite a lot of pretty old infrastructure. As I alluded to earlier, we have completed asset management plans for the five major categories. We revisit those every year, or we have our professionals revisit them and engage council and staff as needed. So they're reviewed every year. And one of the things that's come out of that, and I think as I mentioned earlier, the asset management plan itself is a pretty formidable document, and I don't know how many are like me, but I don't like reading. So what's happened is that there's been a dashboard developed that taken the key information out of that, and this is the information that we present to council. So we've called these dashboards. And the first shot here is of the transportation plan. Some of the things that it has on there, it talks about what we're trying to provide, and I don't know whether you can read that or not, but the service aims are to provide alternatives for movement through town that are safe, inclusive, and efficient. And the second part of that says support development of an integrated transportation network which meets the needs of all users, including pedestrians, cyclists, vehicles, commercial and industrial vehicles. That pie chart is the complete circle is our annual budget. The little orange slice out of there is how much we spend out of that total annual budget on our transportation network. So for us right now, it's about 13%. This chart, or a graph, summarizes all the costs that are involved, so all of our operating, maintenance costs, all of that, including capital upgrades. So you'll see there's a couple of years in there where there's some pretty big spikes, and that's if you have a major upgrade, and that is projected over, are we doing that 10 years now, either 10 or 20, I think that's 20-year projection. So really is a good forward planning tool, and this, what we found is this information is a lot, as from a council perspective, just makes it a lot more, I guess you look at it more than you would if it's if I gave you that much paper to go through, kind of thing. The next slide shows about our current conditions, and if you see the red slice on the top. And the top one there is what we have in poor condition. you can see that if we continue down that path in 10 years, we're going to have a lot of roadway that's in poor condition at the current funding level. So we have to figure out how we're going to mitigate that. Part of that data package also is the amount of the asset that you have, and this is summarized by square meters of the various surface types. So just let you know what we have. And then I think the last slide is a summation of what's the current value of the asset in terms of the total value of your assets. And I for us, for the town of Shellbrook, that was quite an eye-opener. When we finished those plans, I think the valuation of the assets in those five plans was right around the $60 million mark. That's a pretty large corporation, $60 million net worth kind of thing. So that was a real eye-opener for us, and it makes you realize how much communities really do have invested. So I think the last thing I want to point out here is it also identifies what are the associated risks. Inability to fund adequate renewals, infrastructure is one of the risks, and unsustainable service over longer term. And our risk management approach there is develop and fund long-term renewal plans. Actually, we're hoping that our senior partners can help us out in that that endeavor too. Nicole alluded to levels of service and risk, and as we started down that asset management path, this was probably one of the most uncomfortable things that council had to do for a long, long time. Is, you know, what is your level? What level of service are you going to offer? And there's a what I would call a community level of service. So what does your community expect? And the example that I would use there is when you flush the toilet as a homeowner, what do you expect? That it goes away. From the corporate level, there's a whole bunch more things that you have to manage in there in those levels of service about around the regulations and so on. So there's two levels. You know, water's kind of the same way. It's when you turn the tap on, you want potable water. From an operating perspective, there's a whole lot of regulations that we have to meet. So there are two levels of service, and those need to be established by council. And then once you establish those levels of service, is what are the risks associated with providing that level of service or not being able to provide that level of service. And you need to have those written down. And there's a process you go through. And it was quite a stretch for a lot of us on council. It certainly took us out of our comfort zone. What do we use the information for? Because I said at the start, as we go down the path, we're just finding there's more and more and more things that the information becomes usable for. But certainly one of the top priorities is budget and sort of annual work plan. We've used it in determining our utility rates. Are they appropriate? Are we going to be able to maintain what we have at using rates that we have? And in fact, when we, a couple of years ago, had an increase, that was the information we presented to the public. And you know, we had very little kickback from that. People don't like it, but they do understand the whole cost issue. And just overall, it's making informed decisions about asset repair, upgrades, those kinds of things. One of the things that probably was a bit of a surprise to a lot of us at the outset, was what sort of the rule of thumb that says 80-20. So if you build a building that costs you $1 million, that's 20% of the life cycle cost of that. So where's the other $8 million coming from over the life? And you need to be aware of that. And if you think about a lot of the structures that a lot of the assets that we have, it's a pretty big number. And I'm not blaming anyone. It was just the way things were done. But in the past, we haven't made provision for those upgrades. Moving ahead, there's certainly a need for long-term planning, and that would include your official community plan, strategic plan, any of those other things. I guess what we've come to the realization is that a long-term financial plan probably ties everything together, because unless you have the money, nothing's going to happen. So you need to figure that out and integrate all of that whole planning phase. So as we go ahead, we'll continue to develop and upgrade, review our existing plans. We're going to start to develop some long-term financial plans. We think we have a better handle on projected work that's coming up. And one of the things that we want to do is to get out in the community, engage our stakeholders a lot more. We haven't totally figured out how that might happen, but there's been some, we've kicked around some ideas like maybe a citizens committee, that kind of thing. So we'll see where that goes, I guess. So just a few things that I want to really emphasize again, sort of key points, is that asset management plans are not financial reporting asset registers. And I think there's been a lot of confusion around that a lot of folks think that if you have an asset register, you have an asset management plan. Not the case. Asset management plans require the inclusion of projected upcoming maintenance and operating costs, renewal and upgrade, new work costs. You got to have budgets, levels of service. What level of service am I going to provide to my community? What are the risks associated with that, and how would we mitigate those? It gives you current replacement costs. It provides you with projected expenditures over a 10 or a 20 year period and how that compares to your budget. And it also provides us with some insight into how we might manage future demands on our community and their assets. Pardon me. Asset management plans support informed decision making. It is, as I mentioned right at the outset, it's a change in business process. It's the way we do business now within our municipality. And it supports long-term planning and strategic decisions. Asset management plans are doable for small communities. And I think we're a prime example. It's certainly doable, and in my opinion, it's probably cost effective. It's probably saved us money because of doing sort of the preventative maintenance or doing the right thing at the right time rather than letting it deteriorate. Well, it may seem unmanageable in your community. For us, with informed decision making, it is manageable, and we will get it done in a prudent way. Pardon me. With that pretty much wraps up what I want to talk to you about, but I do want to introduce Darian, our next, he's going to talk to you about what Because of asset management and what was happening in our transportation system, we realized that we needed to have a much better handle on what we had and how we manage it. Sorry. To that end, we started a pilot project, the town and ATANA, to develop a road condition management system, and went through that process last year. And Darian will take you through how we did that and what the results are. So with that, Darian. I'll get out of your road here. I might have some of yours, shall we?
Okay, thanks, George. I think we're running a little bit behind, so I'll try to fly through my part here pretty quickly. So the purpose of my slides here, I'll be talking about the road condition assessment that we did. And as George said, these last 5 years, as we've been reviewing and revising their asset management plan, the need has come forward for more information on the road, to get more information on roads to make better informed decisions on their upgrade and renewals going forward. So that's what I'm highlighting here, and basically it's just an example of how asset management can provide you some context of where you should focus your efforts. Okay, so we started the pilot project last year, and we just took a subset of the network in Shellbrook, and we looked at condition assessment and life cycle costing, and then we moved on to develop the proposed roadworks program and the estimated cost for each road segment over the next 10 years. So the approach we're using for the condition assessment is from the Condition Assessment and Asset Performance Guidelines Practice Note 9, which is developed by the IPWEA, and that recommends a 1-5 rating system. So 1 is very good or new, and 5 is very poor or almost being unserviceable. And we're starting here at a simple, what we call a core approach, and that's just based on the visual inspection of the road surface. We're not getting into the material testing or structural testing at this stage. The idea is to get the core approach done and then decide if there's value in getting more information, more detailed analysis. So for each of the 5 categories, this IPWEA guideline that we're using has some descriptions and recommended response actions. So the bullets here just show for a condition 3 or a fair segment, these are the types of things that would describe it. So minor components or isolated sections need replacing. There's some pavement roughness, but it still basically functions all right at a safe and adequate level of service. Failure is unlikely within 10 years, but probably some sort of replacement needs to be done in 5 to 15 years. So if a road does fit into that category, they have some recommended response action plan. So you address any safety defects, first of all, and then you undertake some risk assessment and schedule the appropriate action on that segment. So just a couple examples. So here's that a map of the town of Shellbrook. We'll just pick one road segment there. Here's a picture of it. And here's some information. And this shows how it ties back to the asset management plans, because we can use this information from the asset register and some other information from the plans to support our work here. So for example, this road is cold mix, built in the early 70s. You can see some patching on the left side of the road there and some alligator cracking in the foreground there. So that segment was binned into the fair condition category. So the plan there is for this segment is regular proactive maintenance as required, so some spot patching to address the defects. And after the spot patching is done, this segment is deemed likely to be adequate for several years. So there's no major capital work required in the next 10 years. Again, I'm going pretty quick here, so just to give you an idea of what we're up to here. So another example up further north in the network. So we've got another road segment here. This one is hot mix, built in the late 70s. Just zoom in a bit. You can see a bit of cracking here, but it's in generally pretty good shape at first glance here. So maybe you've already binned it in your mind, but we figured that was in good condition, so condition 2. So that means that no immediate action is required other than some proactive maintenance, and no capital renewals are planned within the next 10 years. So just a couple examples there. So here are the five categories. We've just taken a sample from each. We found a road that represents each category and just had this table. And we're using this as sort of a lookup table when we apply it to the full network. If we take a new road and compare it to this table, see where it fits in. I guess zero at the top there, I should have mentioned, is not rated or gravel roads, which we weren't considering in this part. And it's a bit subjective. Sometimes it's hard to know if it's good or fair. Some are, it's a little bit borderline. But we sat down with town staff and public works, and we were able to all agree the segments that we looked at. We agreed on the appropriate categories there. Okay, so those are the road segments we looked at. You can see about half of them were in good condition, condition one or two. Some were in fair, and then the others were gravel that we didn't consider. Okay, so we've got the condition assessment done here, this core version of it. And now we work towards developing a work plan over the next 10 years. There's some uncertainty in the timing of work, so we grouped it into urgent work, which is the next 1 to 2 years, near-term work, 2 to 5 years out, upcoming work, 5 to 10 years out, and then long-term work, anything after 10 years. So here's a summary of that. So you can see on the left is the urgent work. There was only one segment. There was a full seal required on one segment there for about $50,000. And then 2 to 5 years out, there was one segment planned for a renewal of hot mix. 5 to 10 years out, there were a few segments there that were planned. And then the remainder of the segments we were looking at were likely after 10 years before they needed major renewal. So this is the type of graph we were working towards that would help council understand what the types of, just the magnitude of funding required over the next 10 years for renewals. Okay, so in summary, this work that we're doing is a starting point, and we're relying on public works expertise to support the timing and the planning of work. Ideally, you'd perhaps have some sort of optimization system, but we're starting from the simple end and working our way to get more complex. There's some uncertainty in unit rates and timing, and going forward, we're going to start considering the road hierarchy. So all else equal, a road in the same condition, Main Street versus a road in the corner of the network, the Main Street would take priority. And also consideration of upcoming work for underground infrastructure, so you're not paving a road and then going and digging it up the following year to replace underground infrastructure. Okay, so this type of work can support trade-offs between different road segments. It can help support better understanding of budget requirements going forward and level of service discussions with ratepayers. So the plan here going forward this year is to apply this methodology that I've been through to the full road network in Shellbrook. And the aim is to have sort of a point-and-click map like I've been showing these images so that you can quickly access the road segment with a picture, condition assessment, and all the asset register details tied to it. And it's thought that this will help in council discussions and even communicating with the public. Okay, so a summary of, I guess, George and my slides combined. Shellbrook, we've been at the asset management thing for the past 5 years, making revisions and updating. And completing these first asset management plans can identify where additional information can be helpful to support decision making. Rather than starting with digging down into the details of condition assessment, you start with the asset management plan, and then you can understand where the value is in investing your time. So for this part of the project, we've leveraged the existing information in the asset management plans, and we're working towards developing the upcoming roadworks plan. Yeah, so the outcome is not perfect, but it's thought to be helpful in improving the information to support decision making. Okay, I guess we'll wait. I think we'll wait till questions till the end. Okay, thanks.
Okay. Thanks, George and Darian. Next, we'll have Celine Favreau, and Celine is going to be talking about a regional asset management exercise that she was involved in. So, Celine?
Good afternoon, everyone. Happy to be here. I'm with the MidSask Municipal Alliance, and that is a group of 13 municipalities that are east of Saskatoon that have been collaborating together since 2012. The MidSask Municipal Alliance is focused on managing the impact of economic growth as a result of the establishment of the BHP billet and mine site in Jansen. So to ensure that their communities were best prepared to benefit from the economic impact of the mining industry into the future, the MSMA members made the decision to collaborate regionally. This is a map of the region, and you'll see the yellow spot on the far left is the city of Saskatoon. So we're down Highway 16, the Yellowhead, and those orange spots are our urban municipal members, and the green areas are four rural municipalities that are a part of our district. So the slate of work for the MSMA grows steadily, but the value of the to the municipal members in the region is growing even faster. The MidSask Municipal Alliance continues to find solutions through shared knowledge, improve efficiencies for its members through shared services and resources, and advocate for the improved quality of life for the citizens within the region. These are the achievements to date. Official community plans have been completed for each of the municipal members, and a district official community plan has summarized all of those at the regional level. In 2013, the Alliance hired a director of planning and operations, so that was really a key point, was that the municipalities all made the commitment to inject a level of funding into this entity in order to hire a full-time staff person to work for them. So as George said in Shellbrook, you really do have to make that commitment to hire someone to do what needs to get done, because our resources at the local level aren't always what it needs to be to get to that level. So some of the other things that the group accomplished as well were aligning our zoning bylaws and a regional asset management plan. Now the asset management plan was, we did hire ATANA management as well within the Mid-Sask region to do the asset management directory or the plan or this collect the asset information, the data, sorry. Growing forward, the MidSask Alliance is looking at completing GIS mapping project. We just actually started that mapping project this past summer, so that will align the information, the maps at the local level to digital version, and it will align the information at the local level with the asset management data. Also, the group has started a community economic development initiative, and I think the importance of that initiative is that they are working not only to look at internal ways of increasing the tax base in order to handle the level of infrastructure replacement and the money that's required to keep that infrastructure in place, but also to attract more investment to the region as another way to increase the tax base. BHP Billiton has been an important partner. We've had a corporate partner in this region that has been instrumental in supporting the district and working together collaboratively. And BHP has been involved right since the incorporation of our organization. And just to show you the importance of that collaboration, they contributed $123,000 to completing our asset management plan at the regional level. An asset management plan for each community and then one regional plan. So what they did was they did all 13 plans, and then the city of Humboldt actually internally had compiled their information, so they contributed that data themselves, and then the regional asset management plan project was summarized. So our regional infrastructure replacement strategy is really about looking at that asset management plan, and now we're at the point where we are looking to update that strategy. We're doing our first review with ATANA, and we're working to update that strategy moving forward. So each individual completed asset management plan outlines the infrastructure included, our projected costs relating to operations and maintenance, renewals, upgrades and new disposals in comparison to budget. A summary of upcoming demand and demand management plan, an outline of the current and projected levels of service, and then key strategic risks. So what we've learned through our asset management planning process is that the summary of the infrastructure current replacement costs in our region for our 13 municipal members is for our towns, $199 million, for villages and resort villages, $26 million, and for our rural municipalities, $262 million, for a total cost of $491 million in our planning district. Now, what this graph shows is similar to what George's graph showed. It illustrates all the projected expenditures for the MSMA municipalities, including the city of Humboldt, including operations, maintenance, renewals, and upgrades or new over the next 20 years. And the black line illustrates the projected available budget, an estimated $23 million annually available budget over the next 20 years, and the shortfall stated an estimated overall cost of $32 million would be around $9 million per year at total replacement value. So we're starting to understand the advantages to a regional approach to asset management planning, including the opportunity to share services. We're really looking at ways to identify dealing with this $9 million shortfall. There are starting to become more great examples of municipalities sharing services across Saskatchewan, increased buying power, a regional opportunity to group buy and group tender would increase our buying power. There are examples of cost savings being achieved intermunicipally on infrastructure projects. Shared maintenance staff and equipment is another opportunity at the regional level. The MSMA has been hosting regional meetings of our administrators, and we recently hosted a meeting of all municipal maintenance foremen who brought forward examples of equipment being shared and put forward ideas for additional opportunities to work together to save costs. And also, lobbying power, we've learnt corporate and government agencies are eager to support regional groups that put forward regional asset management strategy projects. So discussion has begun around the MSMA to start to deal with asset management strategies moving forward. We're working at aligning our asset management plan replacement values over the next term of reviewing our plans. We're going to begin public ratepayer meetings, align our project completion goals, and identify key areas for group tendering. Our RMs this year have started to compile their roadwork so that they can group tender between the four of them roadwork projects in the region. Regionally, our best practices, we're beginning to understand where we need to be as a region and as at the community level in dealing with these issues. Some of the things that we've learned are this list, sustainable service delivery, identifying new sustainable service delivery opportunities, regional planning, infrastructure levies, increased taxation, sustainable utility rates, and long-term funding commitments are some of the areas that we've learned are things that we need to dig into a little deeper. So our building blocks moving forward really make up continuing to research best practices, investigate ways to reduce costs. We're going to be completing a 10 to 20 year cash replacement strategy. It's really about creating a business case for our municipalities and for our region to get the job done. Whether we, you know, look at opportunities to maybe combine projects in our infrastructure grant applications to the federal government, so that when we get approval for these projects, they're approved at the group level so that we can tender them as a group so we know that all the projects have been approved. And we're looking to begin working at providing workshops in our region for our municipal members and leaders to bring in community leaders from other districts that have had successes in asset management plans and to start relay that information to our municipalities within our region. Thank you.
Thanks, Celine. Lastly, Joanne Loy will provide her experience as well. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I can see we're running out of time, so I'm really going to shorten mine up because I think you guys are all aware now how important asset management planning is. My biggest issues that I had after I took the face-to-face training in Humboldt in 2012 was time constraints. You're trying to do this on top of everything else that's going in the office. You're trying to find information and look back through records. And it was also very overwhelming. It's definitely a new way of looking at things, at our assets, but it is very beneficial. The RM is the one that has done asset management planning. My village hasn't yet, but I think my mayor will nod that yes, we're going to move forward. So the RM did hire a town of management to do one asset management plan for us. It was started in 2015, finished last summer. And then in August of 2016, I started the online course through NAMS Canada and the IPWEA. I went to mid-November, but when I was done that, I have another asset management plan. It's a great course. It's about $2,700, but it's worth it. It is well worth it. It's online modules. There's videos. You can go back. If you're not understanding something, rewatch the video. There's discussion boards where you can post and ask questions. And I think there was two of us in Canada that actually took the course. All the rest were people in Australia. Our top challenges, like I said before, was time and the overwhelmingness of, okay, how do I get started? Another area we had issues was data updates. Our TCA information is historical costs. For the asset management plan, you need current replacement costs. Fortunately, the RM has been doing road construction recently, so we have a pretty good idea. So your neighbors, your engineering firm are going to be a big benefit once you get rolling to get these current costs. And the foreman, the Reeve, and I sat down over coffee a few times and did a very informal road condition assessment. Just went over the roads we were doing and figured out are they there? Are they able to handle the traffic on them? Do they need to be upgraded? Getting council on board was another issue that we had at first. So we started 2012 and it changed in council. We had some yes, no, we don't want to do this. We don't see a need for it. But the buzzwords of asset management plan had been out for a couple years. And I had one counselor kept saying, we need to manage our assets. And I'm like, okay, what do you mean? But he couldn't tell me. He was just hearing the buzzword. So hopefully the council members that are out here today will have a better understanding of the importance and the need for asset management planning. For us, we see the asset management plan as a link that's going to tie together the financial aspect, the budgets, costs, long-term capital plans, with the operational and functional aspects. Can the condition of this road accommodate its current traffic volume? Does our water well have the capacity to accommodate growth? So it's going to tie those two aspects, financial and functional, together. And our challenges that I see moving forward is, as council and staff change, it's going to be ongoing training. You have to keep everybody up to speed on what's going on. And an asset management plan is a living document. You don't do it once and put it on the shelf. You need to review it. You need to upgrade it. And you have to remember to refer to it and use the plan. And, like, we've had our plan for less than a year, and we're still trying to get used to having it and using the information in it. It'll be better for our budgeting coming up this year. Thank you.
Okay, that concludes our presentation for today, but we have about 10 minutes to for questions and question session. So if anyone has a question, please go up to the mic and just state your name and where you're from, and we'll see if we can answer your questions. I know it's a lot of information in a very short time. Don't forget that we've got the handouts at the front, and also we have a draw for a $100 gift certificate, so make sure you put your business cards in or put your name in the draw, and we'd be happy to help you. So any questions?
Okay. Thank you very much, Shelley. It was a lot of good information in a short time. Can we have a round of applause for our presenters, please? Remember that the presentations will be available on SUMA's YouTube channel later this month. There's a 15-minute break now, sponsored by MPE Engineering.